If you are what you say you are, a superstar, then have no fear. The camera's here, and the microphones, and they wanna know. Oh, oh, oh. If you are what you say you are, a superstar, then have no fear. The crowd is here, and the lights are on, and they wanna show. Oh, 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 yeah.
Yeah, a fresh, cool young Lou, trying to cash his microphone, check 212. Wanna believe my own hype, but it's too untrue. The world brought me to my knees, what have you brung you? Did you improve on the design, did you do something new? Where you naming on the guest list, who brung you? You, the more famous person, you come through. And the sexy lady next to you, you come too. And then the hitman, standing outside of heaven, waiting for God to come and get me. I'm too uncouth, unschooled to the rules, and too gumshoe. Too much of a newcomer, and too uncool. Like Shadow and Lavelle, I battle with it well. Though I need a holiday like Lady Who Sung Blue. Go back, whatever you did, you undo. Heavy as heaven, the devil on me, two tons too.
If you are what you say you are, a superstar, then have no fear. The camera's here, and the microphone's, and they wanna know. Oh, oh, oh.
I'm Sean O'Malley, I'm from Phoenix, Arizona. I train out of the MMA lab. I got involved in fighting when I was 15 years old. I liked boxing a lot, so I started working with a boxing coach, and I just started from there. Boxing, went to kickboxing. Then when I turned 18, I started MMA. What makes me exciting to watch is my style. I come out, I'm spinning, I'm setting stuff up, and I'm knocking dudes out, I'm putting them away. I'm on a 3-fight KO streak. I'm having fun in there, I really am. I'm happy in there, I love it in there. I'm a ball of muscle.
Do that neck as long as you can. Alright, and then the last part was to do some action photos. There you go.
With this opportunity, I'm gonna go out there, I'm gonna knock this kid out. He's similar to the last three guys I fought. He's a orthodox striker, he's too slow. I'm gonna come out there, bounce in front of him, his confidence is gonna go down, I'm gonna kick him in the body, I'm gonna kick him in the head, and the fight's gonna be over in two rounds. Dan, I'm gonna knock this dude out in spectacular fashion, and you're gonna want to sign me.
And here's our boy O'Malley. Hey, Lil Dicky in the house. 22 years old.
He's a baby in the ring.
But 29, you're right about to get your old man strength.
Right.
2-inch reach advantage for O'Malley. 70 and 72. Let's see if he can use it.
Referee Marky Mark Smith in the house.
Right in his face.
Right in there, right now.
He's got that 22-year-old.
Yeah, that spear. He got the spirit of a young man.
Huh?
Like, what's happening? You want to squab or let's get it on?
He's about to throw the crane kick, karate kid up in the mofo.
The average fill-out process is 20 seconds a fight. But this one has been a 5-second fill-out. Application's been filled out real early around here. Oh, he tried to strike.
Oh! Oh!
Put this thing away. Oh! Oh! O'Malley, oh! 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 O'Malley!
O'Malley's got some nasty arsenal to strike in here. What's he gonna pull? What's the rabbit gonna pull out of his hair? Boom. Here
we
go.
Oh! O'Malley! Combination. 3-piece dinner with biscuits. O'Malley! O'Malley!
Sugar Show, says Sean O'Malley. My goodness, Paul.
I like it, man. I like his style. It's different. It's unorthodox, but he's got fundamentals, too, that you don't really see off the bat. He's slipping and ripping punches and counters that you don't just learn overnight. That's comfort. That's hard to do.
Let's take a look, Coach. We'll get the replays. We'll start with the initial shot that put Kashakian in a world of trouble.
Big right hand right on the jaw, sits Kashakian on his butt.
Yes, punch.
Oh! Here we go. This is what finally sat him down for good. Square, straight right, right on the jaw. He slips, boom, right on the chin. Down he goes, walks away, he knows it's over.
Alfred.
Beautiful job in his patented backflip.
Polishes it off as he did last time with the standing backflip. Let's make it official. Mark Smith back inside the octagon.
Our winner by knockout due to a punch, Sean.
Hey, this the next motherfucking champion of UFC, man. The Sugar Show, believe it.
Hell yeah.
Cold, cold with it, man.
Sean, this is Sean. Woo! Snoopo O'Malley.
I'll go to any alley with O'Malley.
When you were having your fight called by Snoop Dogg,
yeah.
How crazy was that?
Yeah, that was...
How crazy was that?
It's so crazy looking at my career, how things have played out so perfect. Like, the fact Snoop Dogg was there, like, that was the first time that, I started kind of getting busy on social media and starting to understand, like, okay, this is going to be a part, like, of my career in my life moving forward. And he would, like, repost me or post me, and then I started getting a bunch of followers from Snoop posting me. And, yeah, that was fucking insane. He's still to this day. I mean, you have a conversation with him, he'll call me Sugar Shane. Sugar Shane. Yeah, he'll still just call me Sugar Shane. So
just keep it.
I'm just like, that's just Sugar Shane for the most part.
That's hilarious.
But yeah, that was massive for my career. Just literally having Snoop Dogg. And it was only that season they had Snoop in Your Eye doing the Snoop cast. I think specifically in that fight, I was eating a vegan diet. I think like 140 pounds when I walked into the cage, weighed in at 136. Like,
wow.
I was just so many things. I remember having a really bad fight camp for that. I had a concussion in that fight camp. I got kneed in the head. Wasn't really sparring. Had the worst training camp of all time. But still, like, that young me was just so confident. I was on, like, I'd just come off a viral knockout over David Nuzzo. Have you seen that one? You've probably seen it where I head kicked him this way and then spinning kicked him the other way. Will you try to find that one?
Yeah, find that.
And so I was just coming off that. So I had this confidence about me. I had knocked a bunch of people out previous in my amateur career. And I think it was like 5-0 pro. And for some reason, like, in the backstage, I remember just being like super, super confident. So this was the fight right before it. Boom.
Oh, wow.
And that was like one of my favorite knockouts of all time. I thought that was just the sickest fuck. And that was in Phoenix. That was the first time I fought on like a bigger card. It was LFA.
With Floyd Mayweather versus Conor McGregor happening in 3 days, you might be thinking, who the fuck is that guy? Whenever you see in the title, Sean O'Malley's making his UFC debut against Tyrion Wearitt, the Ultimate Fighter 26 finale. Let's fucking go! And what I'll say to you, who is Sean O'Malley? What I'll say is, welcome to the Sugar Show. Sean O'Malley is one of the skinny boys. Fuck you, Tam Matt. Coming from Dana White's Tuesday Night Contender Series, he was he stole the show on an entire episode. The episode before, Dana White handed out two contracts. On his episode, Dana White could have handed out two contracts, but his fight was so spectacular, you had to give the contract just to Sean O'Malley. Sean O'Malley came out, man. He was a spectacular performance. It was he's undefeated with 8 fucking straight wins. It was a spectacular knockout on Dana White Contender Series, Dana White's Tuesday Night Contender Series. And after it, man, I made a video of the reaction, said instant classic, because, man, his fighting style in that fight, it literally was like it was spectacular to watch, man.
1, 2 for the crew, 3, 4 for the dough, 5 for the hoe, 6, 7, 8 for death row. Mad niggas about to feel the full effect of intellect, so I can collect respect plus a check. Now I'm fin to get into my men too and take care of this business I need to attend to, cause my rich do, and this rap shit's my meal ticket. So you goddamn right I'ma kick it or get evicted. I bring terror like Stephen King or Black Casanova, running niggas over like Christine. When I rock the spot with the flavor I got, I get plenty of ass, so call me an astronaut. As I blast past another nigga's ass, I thought it was strong, but I smoke him like grass, just like Cheech and Chong. When I float, niggas know it's time to take a hike, cause I grab the mic and flip my tongue like a dyke. I got rhymes to keep you enchanted, produce a smoke screen with the funky green to keep your eyes slanted. So check the flavor that I'm bringing, the motherfucking D.R.E. I keep the motherfucking hands ringing. Yeah. Keep the hands ringing.
Just get shit as if I was a mayor.
Fight week here is so nice.
Super nice.
4-hour drive from Phoenix, so it's the best fight here.
I wouldn't mind buying a house out here. We've been out here since last Tuesday. Okay, your manager's PI.
Check out some chicks.
Check out some chicks. I'm fighting Andre Soccer Mom, Andre Sukunta. Heading down to the locker room, gonna go change it out, hit up our first workout of the day.
Always grinding,
run this place. He's orthodox. He's a decent striker. I'm gonna breeze through him.
We have probably 15 signature moves that I'm like, holy shit. Been working on him since he was 17 years old. He came down pretty green. Like, we had to build him up. He didn't know really how to wrestle, didn't know really how to do jiu-jitsu, but he's always had a really, really good kind of cocky mindset. Not afraid to put himself in uncomfortable situations.
Andre, you're fucked, brother.
Jennifer Lopez would be fucking sweet. She's sexy.
I believe she's like 50.
Oh, makes even hotter. Sin City at Planet Hollywood. Ooh, I think I found one. Crazy girls.
Fuck yeah.
Nice. I'm down, you down?
Soccer Mom. I was sitting at this fight, and I remember watching him knock out Luke. I'm like, hell yeah, I want that kid next. Tim texted me right after the fight. He was in the back. Said, let's get that kid. We are set to go. Oh, back knee is looking a little weak. Super tight. Definitely the
taller, longer guy here at 135. The bigger they are, the slower they are.
Yeah, sir. He doesn't have any crazy special striking. He doesn't have any crazy special wrestling. His one good attribute is he's tough.
Close your eyes, Andre. Close your eyes and throw something. Dude,
that's his only hope, is a counterpunch. If he tries to get offensive on you, that's going to be a bad move on his part.
Fuck yeah. Ooh. Close your eyes, throw a right hand.
Look at how surprised he is.
He's like, holy fuck, I won!
Saturday night, though. Our move of the fight is sponsored by Metro PCS. We will find out.
Hey, buddy.
Show me, show, baby. Show me those fucking teeth.
So I don't have to smack him up too early. That looks hard.
What, heels?
Yeah.
Upstairs, fuck yeah, but going down is the worst.
Ooh, I can't even imagine. Dude, I'm gonna say cat and then Gunna looks hot as fuck.
Oh, dude, just compliment her, not be a bitch.
Whoa. Oh, he just tried sticking his hand in my face. And, you know, doing a lot of talking and don't disrespect me like that, you know what I mean?
About to bust open this open workout. We were gonna just do our own like somewhere else, but we didn't have any mats. I was gonna crash it, but now I think they're letting me get my own spot. So either way, we're gonna run this.
UFC fans here in Las Vegas, Nevada. We'd like to welcome you to the weigh-in for UFC 222. Here is Joe Rogan.
Sugar Sean O'Malley versus Andre Sukunta. Official weight 135.5 for Mr. Sukunta. Official weight 136 for Mr. O'Malley. Andre Sukunta and Sean O'Malley, ladies and gentlemen.
So here is the Rhode Island native, Andre Sukumtat, the first fighter of Laos descent to be signed by the UFC.
Excellent striking and legitimate knockout power. And a lust for the competition. That's what makes this exciting.
Ladies and gentlemen, watch and enjoy. The Sugar Show is upon us. Here is the Montana native, the 23-year-old Sean O'Malley.
And some people said it may be too much, but as you alluded to earlier, Joe, if he blows the roof off this place, he goes to a level even he couldn't imagine.
The 23-year-old switch stance fighter, Sean O'Malley, taking on the 29-year-old Andre Sukumtat. O'Malley 2 inches taller. He will have a 2-inch reach advantage.
Andre, the Asian sensation, Sukumtat. Fighting out of Glendale, Arizona, Sugar Sean O'Malley.
Platinum Mike Perry tells you don't get a tattoo on your face until you've made it. Sean O'Malley's on pay-per-view tonight.
Oh, nice outside kick by O'Malley.
He heard him. He heard him.
Oh, nice right hand by Sukumtat.
Tight.
Because everything's changing. That's the second outside kick that's really affected Sukumtat.
Look at that. Oh!
He ate that kick.
He hit
took
him clean.
That whole kick. Yep.
He hit him clean. Oh!
Sukumtat back to his feet.
Oh!
Wow! Spinning attack from O'Malley.
Fuck the bullshit. Let's go fight.
Let's go fight. Believe in yourself, son. Believe in yourself here. Go take this motherfucker. You hear me? Oh. Oh, right hand.
Big deep breath from Sukumtat.
He hurt his foot. O'Malley hurt his foot or his leg.
Yeah, he did.
Look at that. He kicked it. If you're Sukumtat, Joe, you got to let him go to try to make him stand.
Gonna be interesting if we get back to the center to see how O'Malley
barely can stand. Look
can't
at that.
Put pressure on the right foot.
Kicking it. No!
And again, Sukumtat with a wayward shot.
I don't understand what Sukumtat's doing here.
His corner.
Big elbow. Joe, spinning elbow. They are begging him to let him back to his feet.
Right.
O'Malley was hopping up on one leg, trying to fight.
An appreciative Vegas crowd here as Andre Sukumtat and Sean O'Malley go the distance.
Might have a broken leg or broken foot.
Ref comes in there and squeezes on it.
Let's take a look at it here. Wow. It's crazy how anything can happen.
Sugar Sean O'Malley!
I can't feel it. It went numb and I couldn't even step on it. I think it was a question mark kick. Oh, it really hurt. But nothing a little medicine can't fix after the fight, after my after party. I love this game. I love the talk. I love the media. And I love everything about this sport. And I fucking love you, Joe Rogan.
Well, I fucking love you too, buddy.
Welcome to the Sugar Show, everybody.
There's always new up-and-coming rising stars. And for sure, Sean O'Malley is one of those guys. He's very well-rounded. He's talented. He's energetic. He just has that thing. People go crazy.
Sean O'Malley, a guy that you're happy about, of course. He had an impressive performance tonight as well. Kind of a bizarre ending. First of all, do you have a medical update on him, how he's doing, and can you tell us, what you thought of his performance?
They don't think it's anything really crazy, but, they're going to let me know as soon as they... But yeah, the kid's fun to watch. He's exciting, and people love to watch him. The crowd really likes him, so...
You referenced O'Malley, but you know what amazed me is when he got hurt and he's on the ground, he got up on his feet and he couldn't put any weight on his right foot, and he was going to fight. I think it was a minute and a half left to go in the fight. He's going to fight with his right leg off the ground.
Right.
I mean,
and threw a spinning elbow and landed it.
Right.
But he fought his ass off right to the end. I couldn't understand why was laying on top of him instead of making him stand up and get up.
YouTube fam, what up? It's Sugar Shane here. Just took a little Dr. Dabski dab, and I'm feeling goofy. You know, I was thinking, you know what, I'll share a little something with you guys. You know? What really happened when I fought Andre Sockerman, what happened to my foot? Let me show you. During that fight, it's a pretty sweet fight though. You guys saw I hit him with a little 360 head kick. fucking stop down. Boom, hit him with another head kick.
Fighting position. Look at that. Oh, he ate that kick. He took clean.
Was also hit him with the little boom, dropped him. Then after I dropped him, I hit him with the fucking boom. Boom, a little nuzo, hit him with that.
Took him top back to his feet.
What else did I do? Hit him with a little 360 guard pass, knee on belly. Anyway, how I broke my foot. Whew, gosh, that was a little hot up. It's a little hot up. How I really broke my foot, I'm gonna tell you guys. Oh, shit. This is harder than you think, man. This was harder than you think. How I really broke my foot. It was in the third round. I was piecing him up. And I heard a couple people saying he took my legs out. He didn't hit my legs until after I broke my foot. What happened was, I threw a little teep kick, you guys know that, a little up the middle.
He needs the finish. Front kick to the body. Maybe he thinks he can if he can get it to the ground.
Then I would throw a question mark kick.
Let's take a look at it here. Wow, just didn't. It's crazy how anything can happen. And it, sometimes it just doesn't seem like.
Like this, and then you come over the top. And when I did that, because I'm so fucking fast and so explosive.
Oh, right.
And I'm just so fast, so explosive, so cute. Boom! When I landed the kick, that's not what hurt it. I heard a podcast the other day, Andre said that he's made of steel and his forearm broke my foot. That's not what happened. Threw the kick, boom, and when I landed on the back, come show my feet. I got nice feet. When I landed the kick, boom, right when I landed, I went to throw a right hand, and my foot snapped. It's called a Liz Frank injury. It's like a pretty major surgery. It can be like a career ender for people, you know what I'm saying? My shit healed back up. Legitimately took 2 years, two full years for my foot to not hurt. But yeah, that's what happened. Boom, threw a teep kick, threw a question mark kick, landed and went to throw a right hand, and my foot snapped, boom. And then I looked down at it because it just felt so weird. And then he kicked my leg, and then he took me down. That wasn't very smart.
Because they announced October 6th could be versus Connor. So that I was originally going to, in my mind, I got an MRI. They said I have a torn labrum in my right hip. I could do surgery or physical therapy. And before that fight got announced, I was considering probably doing surgery. But now, after talking to the physical therapist at the UFC, Heather, I think we're going to do physical therapy and try to get on that card because I really want to be on that card.
Both Sean and Dana said they want him on the start off the pay-per-view.
Sean Shelby and Dana both told me they wanted me to start off that pay-per-view. And fuck, that's going to be the biggest fight in UFC history. And I'm going to be the beginning of that card and then eventually be the main event of the biggest fight in history.
Love you, Joe Hogan. Love you too, buddy. Welcome to the Sugar Show, everybody!
Sugar Show on O'Malley, ladies and gentlemen!
The whole event, like the fight week, the media, the outfit, just everything about fighting, and I'm planning on going out there and stealing the whole show.
What's up, guys? Sugar Shows. We're going to be coming out with weekly YouTube content. So it's Monday morning, my first practice of the week. We're at the MMA lab. We're going to do strength and conditioning with J-Rock.
Joe Murphy.
Skyler, you guys run the show here. Kickboxing room. Coach Eddie, he's the striking coach of the lab. Coach Eddie! And then this is the morning jiu-jitsu class. This is where we do our protein. We've got the cage in there. Stretching out Jarrett Kenner. He's also in the UFC. So we're about to do our first strength conditioning. Not of camp. I kind of started camp last week. We're 7 weeks out right now.
So this week we're going to pick up the intensity a little bit and get into shape. So here we go.
What's up, everyone? Episode 10. And we're doing all right. We've been doing better as the fucking Sugar Show team. We've been doing better. But
so we got some breaking news. No one's heard. What's today? Thursday? How many days out are we? 20. We're like 2 weeks out about.
20th, yeah.
USADA called me yesterday and said that I had tested positive for a banned substance called Osterine or something like that. Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Osterine. They said it was such a small amount that it pretty much has to be a tainted supplement, which is what it comes down to, I think, is what a tainted supplement is a supplement that doesn't have that ingredient in the ingredients or whatever.
Yeah, it's not mentioned in the ingredients, and then that's pretty much what it is. So, like, what we think it was, what we pretty much know it was the caffeine pills. A caffeine pills that were, they were like $6 pills that we got at One Stop.
First of all, for the people who don't know, can you just explain from top to bottom what exactly happened with USADA? How's your, you know, the last year been for you and the Osterine and everything? Just tell me from top to bottom what exactly happened.
So I was going to fight Jose Quinones October 6th on the Conor Khabib card. 3 weeks out from the fight, USADA called that I had failed a test from, I had a substance called Osterine in my test. And, so they said I wasn't going to be able to fight. And then it was just a long process from there because USADA didn't really know what to do with it because how many people had been testing for it. Not just in the UFC, but in sports in general, they've been having a huge problem with Osterine. So they weren't really sure what they were going to do. Like I literally just found out a couple weeks ago that how long I was going to get suspended for. And that happened back in September. So I was suspended the entire time from September until, just recently, but they weren't sure how long they were going to suspend me. They weren't sure exactly what they were going to do. So they finally came out with a statement not too long ago that I was suspended for 6 months, which the suspension was already up. So it was just a long process, super expensive as far as, you know, you got to pay the lawyer, you got to test the supplements. I tested, I think, 10 or something supplements and found out I didn't find anything in any of the supplements. The other four or five UFC fighters also tested all their supplements, didn't find what it was either. And I guess Osterine's the number one, like, contaminated, that's in the most contaminated supplement, it's Osterine, and they knew that, and they're trying to figure out what to do. So I think they changed the levels of it to where they said that everyone who tested for it in the UFC, was the levels were so low that there was no performance enhancing benefits. It was literally a drop of water in a lake. It was such a small amount that there was they said that they knew that none of us were taking it intentionally. So they let us all with some small suspensions, but, yeah, it sucked. It was weird not being able to have a fight coming up. Cause that's what I do for a living. Obviously I fight. So not being able to fight and they're not having anything coming up, not even knowing when I'm going to have something coming up. It was different. It was really different, but, it all worked out.
As a young guy, is it hard to stay positive? Because I imagine I would be thinking, oh God, it's all over this early in my career. I'd start panicking. Did you have that moment? Were you freaking out when this all happened? Because it's kind of like new territory for you, right?
Yeah, it was. I read, I listened to a lot of podcasts, read some stoicism books, kind of learned about the Stoics. And I feel like that last year, I learned more in that year than I had, you know, my entire life. I learned so much, not even a lot about myself. And I got to study a lot more things rather than, and I had to get surgery on my hip. So I got surgery. So I wouldn't have been able to fight really too much anyway, cause I just got that surgery. So I had two surgeries last year. So I was out for a good amount of time, even if I didn't get suspended, but no, it wasn't too bad.
Thank you. I remember when I had my Liz Frank surgery on my foot, you know, there was an option. The two surgeries was the one with they put the screws in or whatever, and then they have to redo the surgery or surgery and take them out or do whatever I did. I did what I did, so I don't have any metal in my foot, but yeah, I don't know.
How long did that take you to recover from?
Dude, the Liz Frank surgery took legitimately 2 years to stop hurting.
Wow.
But I was probably training on it too soon. I probably wasn't doing exactly everything. This was 2018, so I was, you know, kind of learning about eating healthy, and I was still learning a lot of stuff, so I might not have taken care of it the best way, but legit 2 fucking years. That foot hurt so bad. Like,
ugh.
I would train and it would just ache. I would have to ice it every day. It was miserable. The Liz Frank surgery was miserable.
What is specifically the injury that causes that surgery?
That happened in my fight when I was laying on my back talking to you. So I threw the head kick, and then right when I threw the head kick, I planted and threw a right hand, and my foot snapped when I landed. So
it's the bones in the middle of the foot.
Yeah, and the tendons and shit. Oh God, it was fucking.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah, that was fucked. And then I remember I got like, I had to get like an extra, I remember I went to the Vegas doctor when I, after the fight, and they said, no, you're fine. And then they told Dana, oh, his foot's fine. And then Dana said at the post-fight conference, like, my foot was fine. I got carried out in a stretcher and everyone was making fun of me. And, but yeah, my fucking foot snapped in half. And then I went to another doctor in Arizona. They did x-rays and shit, and they're like, oh, it's fine. So it was like the third doctor I went to. They're like, oh, your foot's torn in half. I'm like, how the fuck are these doctors not fucking finding this? It's like, you're a fucking, yeah.
So it was 2 years before there was no pain. How long before you had full movement?
I don't even remember. I just remember fucking definitely, I wasn't able to run for like 2 years, like grappling, just bouncing around hurt, but I could still do it. But I was like just doing it through the pain. I'd always have to wrap it a certain way. I don't even remember though.
And so what was it like fighting with that?
So now it feels really, now it feels fine. I feel like I feel it if I'm really eating bad.
Did you have any fights where it came up after that?
No, it's been feel like I haven't had any issues with it.
So from that injury, how long was it before you fought again?
2 years.
Two solid years.
2018 to 2020.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, I'd gotten suspended from the Osterine.
Right.
Which worked out perfect in a way because I was dealing with this. I was trying to I booked a fight like a year or something later. I was supposed to fight Jose Quinones. And like I was going into that fight super fucked up. My foot was in so much pain, and I was going into that fight, and I was a couple weeks out before the I got suspended, and then so I couldn't fight because the suspension, but it was so perfect timing because my foot was so fucked up.
Mm.
So it was like very beneficial that I couldn't fight. But then yeah, 2 years later.
Got into Vegas just now. Literally in 2 days it'll be 2 years since my last fight. Like, it's Shooter Show 2.0. like, I was fun to watch 2 years ago, and my skill level just increased so much. So you know, I'm excited KO. That they're excited. Viral KO, like something in me that just knows like something about to happen. It's gonna be beautiful. I'll grab my gloves. They're in my bag. I'm just so excited to go out there. You know, it's so close. I feel calm, and you know, I've never felt this good going to do a fight. I've never been this strong. I've never been this sharp. You know, I feel like that's really, really true for this fight. I feel good.
Que pues ahora que traigo las ganas y ese rencor que
ahora lo traigo todo acumulado para poder hacer un buen ritual azteca, ¿no? O sea,
I started up my sparring again, and it didn't take long for me to start feeling sharp, accurate, and all that. That comes back really quick.
God, even in that fight, I look so much skinnier. Jose gonna try to kick my lead leg. Every single fight, just kicking that lead leg. I think he does that just to kind of feel comfortable. I was listening to an interview and he said he's gonna try to knock me out. So, hopefully, maybe I got him fired up. I'm gonna knock this bro. That would be great if he tried that. That'd be fantastic.
UFC fans, we'd like to welcome you to the weigh-in for UFC 248. Here is Joe Rogan.
Official weight 135.5 for Mr. Quinones. Official weight 135.5. Jose Quinones and Sean O'Malley, ladies and gentlemen.
Welcome to the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada, the scene of UFC 248.
Well, the wait for the return of the Sugar Show ends here. And tonight, arguably the hottest prospect in the bantamweight division, Sean O'Malley is back.
I want to make a statement for sure tonight. I want to go in there and put his lights out.
After announcing his arrival on season one of Dana White's Contender Series in 2017, Sean O'Malley has continued to shine. Tonight, O'Malley is back for his fourth straight bout in Las Vegas to battle Jose Quinones. Winner of five of his last six, Mexico's Jose Quinones has come a long way from his days as a finalist on The Ultimate Fighter Latin America.
Buscando ahora sí que el título, pero pues paso a paso, ¿no? Primero busco el ranking y de ahí pues, para el Real.
And he wishes that he had been a little bit busier, Joe, but he's talked a lot about the valuable developmental time. He's had 6 months to prepare for this one. And
he said he was a tough Latin American bantamweight finalist. He's a very talented fighter. And one thing that he has going for him is that he has been more active.
Don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I'm rocking my pants.
Pretty evident afterwards. I mean, can you just tell us kind of what that moment was like and maybe how many times you had been thinking about that moment over and over and envisioning it happening?
Yeah, I definitely had envisioned that, you know, standing there talking to Joe a lot, and I just let myself kind of just feel it all and let it all in and felt good.
Yeah, pretty flawless performance, man. I think a lot of us thought, man, it's the time away. It's going to be a little rusty, that sort of thing. How'd you feel when you walked in there? I mean, was timing difficult, or did anything feel different or at all?
No, I kept laughing every time everyone asked me if I'm going to have ring rust or is that time away going to make me. I think it did nothing but benefit my performance, and I was able to, you know, get really good in those last couple years I've been off. So I every time I got asked about that, I kind of laughed.
You had so much momentum behind you when you stepped away. Was there any thought when you stepped in there tonight, like, I got to do something special? I mean, I got to really recapture that magic, so to speak.
No, I think just the way, you know, fighting in general is such a sweet thing, but I think just the way I fight, it's not necessarily too entertaining. I think it's just an entertaining style, and that's just the... I didn't feel like I had to do anything besides be me in there, and that's what happened.
All right, so last thing for me, I mean, what now? Now that all the hurdles are out of the way, I mean, are you wanting to fight, you know, well, that first time? I say, and then, I mean, are you wanting to fight, like, frequently? Or, did, I mean, you said you got better with time off. I mean, how do you see your career progressing from this point?
Yeah, I don't know. I want to obviously fight. I'm healthy, so I don't think they have any fights in Vegas till International Fight Week, so I'm gonna have to go check out which cards
where I'd like to fight. You know, I feel like I'm in a position where I can say, I'd like to fight there, I'd like to fight there. So I'm going to go look at the calendar, look at it, check it out. If nothing pops up, maybe International Fight Week.
Physically, it looks bigger than your first two fights. Is that time up? How much weight
did you have? Yeah, against Andre, I walked in, you know, fight camp around 148 pounds. This fight camp, we started at 156, so I put on a lot of muscle. I've been working with Brandon Harris in Phoenix, like, with a strict strength and conditioning program, you know, not just lift every once in a while or, you know, hit a couple squats. Like, we stuck with the strength and conditioning program, and I just trusted in him. And, you know, he said, imagine how good you could be 20% stronger. And I just thought about that. I'm like, that's scary. I feel like that's a scary, scary bantamweight. Me, but 20% stronger at that time. And I feel like now we're here and I'm that. So.
You didn't feel any heavier than there, was still safe.
Yeah, I think right now I'm probably 150 pounds. Going in against Andre, I was probably 144. Like, I didn't get that much. So, you know, I'm not way bigger, but my body feels stronger. I'm not getting injured as much, you know. I feel way healthier. And my speed feels, I feel faster, and I obviously feel stronger. And my cardio feels better. So, yeah, I just feel all around better. What's up, Forrest?
And I like the way, with even though, like, the COVID going on, like, I like the way they're running the whole pre-fight. The
hotels
thing.
And stuff.
Yeah,
nice.
Everything's running smoothly.
I enjoy it. Nothing's changed for me. I've been training twice a day and streaming on Twitch. Doing, literally, my life didn't change at all. Everyone keeps asking me that. I'm like, nothing's changed.
That's pimping. It's more people, like, I'll have people DM me, like, are you actually Ben Askren's son? It's like, no, I'm not.
Whether he comes forward and pushes the action, he'll get knocked out, or if he lets me push him backwards, he'll get knocked out. So it just works out perfect.
You know, I've been in there and mixed it up with the best in the world. Uriah Faber, Benavidez, you know, Brad Pickett, Scott Jorgensen, you know, all those guys. I've mixed it up with them, you know. Not that Sean couldn't do it. I feel he could go in there and he could mix it up very well with those guys. But I've been there and done that, so I know how to adapt to that. I think that's an advantage in my court.
Got a good sweat. Just rode the bike for 30 minutes. Start sweat. Cut some tonight, 4 or 5 tonight, and then wake up and cut the rest tomorrow. And that'll be it.
What up, four?
Hey, how much?
Welcome, guys, welcome.
All right, first fighter to the scale in the UFC's bantamweight division, Sugar Sean O'Malley.
136.
Brace looking good, man. Thank you. Eddie Wineland.
136.
We will begin with the main card for UFC 250 live on pay-per-view through ESPN Plus. First up in the bantamweight division, Eddie Wineland versus Sugar Sean O'Malley.
Let's be cool, let's be cool.
All right, so here he is, the rising star, Sugar Sean O'Malley, 25 years of age, a perfect 3-0 in the UFC thus far. And
he's got it in spades.
Yeah, he's got it in spades, man. He has it. People are drawn to Sean O'Malley. But as Sean O'Malley walks into the octagon, you got to remember, two undefeated fighters tonight lost their oath.
All right, with the best mustache in the sport and respect to the rest, here is Eddie Wineland, born in Houston, Texas, calls Indiana home. Wineland, 10 years O'Malley's senior. Sean O'Malley is the taller man. He will also enjoy a 3-inch advantage in reach.
Fighting out of Glendale, Arizona, Sugar Sean O'Malley, former WEC bantamweight champion, Eddie Wineland.
It throws very good counter shots.
Nemerov, bold character since 1872, and a bold right hand from Eddie Wineland finds the target.
He's got to be careful here, though, because when you're engaging O'Malley, look, he does a fence.
Oh! The lockup KO! The Sugar Sean!
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my goodness. He slept him bad.
Eddie's still out.
Oh, my goodness.
He's still out, and he's snoring.
See how Eddie's hand went down to try to find the uppercut, and then O'Malley just dropped that right hand right over the top.
Crazy.
That was nasty. I mean, but look at how subtle that feint was.
He makes quick work of a very difficult challenger in Eddie Wineland.
Declaring the winner by knockout, Sugar Sean O'Malley.
This was a big name in Eddie Wineland, a former WEC champion, and the result was, in my opinion, the best walk-away KO I've ever seen.
Yeah, I think that was worth 100 Gs. Rather than 50 Gs. But I'll continue to do this throughout my career. I really do believe I have the best striking in MMA. Hopefully renegotiate my contract like I was supposed to do last time and figure out what's next.
Well, good luck to you, sir. Congratulations on a truly spectacular performance.
I fucking love you, Joe Rogan.
I love you too, brother.
Today's 7 days out from the fight. It's the last real hard push. We're gonna do 3-5, simulate the fight. Just kill.
3 minutes in the round. Tommy on his back. Sprawl stuff his head. Stuff his head when you can. Circle. That's beautiful. One more time.
I feel good. I'm healthy. It's three camps back-to-back-to-back where I've had no injuries. So, you know, it's super rare. We've just been training so smart, confident. I just feel super dangerous right now.
Twitch fam, what's up, baby? Big Chungus, Isaac, Nate, Bedside, what's up, baby?
You know, I got the YouTube, Twitch, podcast, fighting, posting on Instagram. Every day is how can I get better?
Ooh! That's gonna be on embedded too.
We're just getting started still. That literally felt more exhilarating than knocking out Eddie. My last fight was the first time we did it, and people loved it. Just loved it. And then the hair is just, you know, I just wanted to do it at the Ecuadorian flag. Then these girls are the ones creative on how to make it happen. So, oh.
Emotional green.
Yay. You did awesome. Good job.
Awesome. How's it going?
I go through phases where I'll read a lot more. I think those 2 years off, I was reading like every day. This describes how I feel in the cage. I remember saying in my fights, I'm tough, I feel it's possessed. I don't feel like it's necessarily me in there. So it's weird going back and rewatching it because it's like watching it almost like for the first time. Things that I always take, my humidifier, an air filter, a couple video games, foam roller. Usually I'll pack a couple sweet outfits with some sweet shoes and stuff.
Which is your room? Is the same, right?
Okay.
Yeah, I don't mind.
It is quiet, but at the same time, it's fight week. Like, nothing matters right now. Like, all these changes, like, they don't with my mind. Like, nothing. Like, world change, like all these COVID things. I just say positive, and I do enjoy the ride. I'm happy. I'm alive. Saturday night, I'm getting to a fist fight.
Are we allowed to shoot hoops?
I watched Michael Jordan last dance, baby.
Just getting in Vegas, the energy here is just... Every time I come here, I'm whooping someone's ass, so it's feels good. Feels good to be here. So Wednesday, Thursday, when we make weight, and then it's Saturday, and it's going to be Sunday before you know it. All this is going to be over before... You know, it goes by so fast, so just enjoying all this. I enjoy it all. I love submissions. I love jiu-jitsu. It's my favorite sport by far. But knocking people out is the best feeling. And I think the fans, they do want to see a submission from me because I knock everyone out. But I think ultimately if I go out there and knock him out the way I plan, it's going to be way more exciting than if I go out there and choke him.
And I just like to be active. When I make the run to become a UFC fighter, I was literally fighting every 50 days in South America. I was like, this is what I want. I want to be here. I want to be in the big show, in the spotlight. So that's why I like to fight a lot, because that's how you get things done. That South American fighting, they put us in there to break our faces. And at the end of the day, dude, it's a fight. So just go in there and f-ing let it go.
Are you enjoying the process? Are you enjoying sort of the journey leading to your destination, the belt?
I think this is my third fight in, 6 months? So, yeah, we're on pace for four, but, definitely not looking past Cheeto, and I know what can happen in a fight.
Kung Fu? Probably gonna do some Kung Fu. That's the most important thing to focus on for this fight.
The guy called me out. He want a little bit of me. That means, he want to take my spot. I'm prepared, I'm ready, and I'm ready to go to deep waters and have f***ing fun,
When you're in shape, you're not worried. Looking back, all the work was done. Good food, good recovery, hard work, so gas tank for days, baby. Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Face down, up, baby.
It's a love-hate relationship with the first round knockouts, because I love watching my fights back. My last two fights were less than 5 minutes put together.
Yeah, double jab, bum, bum.
Fastest motherfucker in the world. Baddest motherfucker in the world. Unbreakable. Boom.
First round knockout, you can't complain. If I knock him out in the second, third, doesn't matter.
Well, Molly, what up, bro?
Just sweat, burn some calories, and move around. Cut some weight. The jack now.
All right, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the weigh-ins.
136.
Official weight 136 for Marlon Vera.
136.
136, the official weight for Sean O'Malley. Our co-main event is at bantamweight. Sugar Sean O'Malley takes on Marlon Cheeto Vera.
Ooh. Okay. Actually, yeah. We're gonna see each other tomorrow.
Dateline, Las Vegas, Nevada.
Yeah, I'm gonna put on my face shield before this matchup because I have a feeling there's gonna be a lot of blood coming out of the octagon. These guys both throw such heavy hands and they mix together all their techniques.
And of course, out of the blue corner tonight will be Marlon Cheeto Vera, Joe.
I agree that this is probably the toughest fight we've seen so far.
for Sugar Sean O'Malley. Chito Vera is a wild man.
He's an emotional guy, but certainly not an emotional fighter. This has been his life's dream, and he has wanted this O'Malley fight in the worst way. Sean O'Malley is a sniper on the feet. He is underrated as a grappler and seems to move a lot of needles that matter as he faces the 14-time UFC veteran Chito Vera. The co-main event is coming up next.
When I was a young kid, I knew I was going to do something. I knew I was going to be famous.
What's up, bitches?
And I remember telling my friends I was going to be, and they're like, how? I don't know, dude, but I'm going to be.
Excuse me.
For my career, the goals I have, I want to be that A-list kind of celebrity. I want to be that Michael Jordan. Started
from the bottom. Oh, he tagged with that right hand. Threw him down.
Tied. Oh, O'Malley goes high. The Sugar Show, live and in color. Everybody knows the sound. What you think about? Well, Chito Vera has accrued a lot of UFC experience pretty quickly here. Started from the bottom,
now I'm with the the liver!
The body shot cripples Bruin! Chito Vera!
I can beat anybody. I know that, I proved that, I showed that. I beat this guy, and then I fight somebody in the top 10 and I keep climbing.
The Sugar Show goes to 13-0, and I'm going to continue to be undefeated.
Here he is, Mr. Congeniality.
The thing about Chito is the way that he comes forward, the way that he heads guys off, the way that he forces people to fight when they don't want to. He had surgery on a Lisfranc injury, which was a slight crack in his foot and a hip torn labrum. Over that 2 years, he fixed his whole body up. He focused on his mind. He does a cold plunge every day. He's always taking care of his body.
Sean O'Malley is 25. Marlon Chito Vera still just 27, despite the wealth of UFC experience. O'Malley's got 3 inches in height, an inch and a half in reach.
Fighting out of Chone Manabi, Ecuador, Marlon Chito Vera! Out of Glendale, Arizona, Sugar Sean O'Malley!
Here we go.
Ooh, heavy low kick.
That 2 year layoff, he really dedicated himself to grappling and fell in love with that part of the game. Hasn't had to lean on that too much of late.
The stance switch of Marlon is going to help a lot with that low kick right there. He's going to have to start switching more often just like that because Sugar's already found that low kick.
And those are heavy shots. Oh, every time he turns orthodox.
These guys are so long in their lower halves, Joe. We do measure leg reach right now, and both of these guys from hip to foot have a longer leg reach than Stipe Miocic, the heavyweight champion.
Nice. Beautiful. High kick.
Yes.
He faked the low and went high.
Well, this is absolutely the most experienced guy.
Something's wrong with O'Malley's leg.
Right
leg. I don't know what happened. He hurt his knee in another fight, Sean.
It was the Terrion Ware fight, right?
Yeah, he broke his foot in that one. That's what it was. And it looks like the similar thing has happened here. Still got to be careful because that right hand of his is powerful. So Chito's taking his time.
Yeah, you see the limp there.
I guess you got to just hope maybe for Sean that it's a nerve issue that could recover.
Yeah, will he up? He fell down.
Oh! Huge elbow from Shield! Another one! Marlon Chito Vera!
Interesting stoppage.
Crazy stoppage.
It was quick. I mean, it was quick.
Even in the back, warming up, everything was just perfect.
Yeah, it really
was. I'm in fucking good shape. Mm-hmm. I'm breaking this motherfucker 100% in my mind. Mm-hmm. Get back there, doing our warm up. Everything's going perfect. About 5 minutes before they said, "All right, we're gonna walk." I'm like, "Hey, Brandon, do you think you could fucking loosen up my ankle brace? It's like fucking tight." So he's sitting in the back, loosening up my ankle braces because they were so tight. And that's about walked out. Everything felt good. Got in there, was in front of him. I'm like, This felt in my mind. I'm like, this is easy. He's slow. He can't hit me.
Once he swung at you and that little flurry went through your mind, like, fuck.
I'm like, dude, he's slow. Uh-huh. He can't hit me. If you can't hit me, you can't take me down. I didn't think he was going to be able to get me down because he was so slow. And I remember the pain that I had in the top of my foot, the Liz Frank surgery, had the same pain, but in my all around my ankle.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember dragging my foot up against the cage, like, fuck. Even still, didn't feel in danger.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, I can't. I'm not very mobile, but I'm not. I don't feel in danger. I don't feel like he's a threat. I was hoping he'd shoot in on me so I could try to guillotine him, but mm-hmm. I'm like, okay. Fucking cracked him with a good shot. And then that last little flurry I had, I don't think he hit me. Well, I don't think he punched me once on my feet, even mm-hmm. after my foot was fucked up. I don't think he hit me.
Well, I heard you complain about that ankle wrap a little bit too. And then even right after the fight, you're like, my foot felt like it was asleep in the fight.
Yeah, I mean,
felt like it was asleep.
The thing is like we picked the date, we picked the time, and we both walked out, and then it doesn't matter what the fuck happens. Whoever wins, however they win, wins.
Yeah.
So he won. It feels like it sucks for me because I'm like, God, I lost to someone who I look at is not very good. Mm-hmm. I look at him and I'm like, he's not that good, and I fucking lost to him. That's what's the most frustrating thing, probably, is just losing to someone I'm better than. And that humble post was a fucking joke. So everyone commenting stupid shit. I'm not humble.
Yeah. That's the thing about fighting. You've been around it long enough that it's not always the better guy wins. Because fighting.
But that's also why I love fighting so much.
Yeah, is it?
Because it's not always the better guy wins. It's whatever the fuck happens.
Yeah.
But I was like, God, I did everything right. I can't look back on that and be like, ah, well, I could have done that better. I did everything right. There was nothing I did wrong.
Mm-hmm.
The sparring, the training, the fucking eating, the sleeping, everything I did was fucking right. But also what makes me feel better, it's like, okay, let's look at his career in 5 years. Let's look at mine. I'm going to be fucking world champ, and he's going to be a fucking journeyman. Mm-hmm. That's just what his style is. He wins some, he loses some.
Mm-hmm.
He's slow, but he's gritty, so he's mm-hmm. gonna be able to finish some people after they beat him up for a while. Dude, I'm like, the way his pace was super slow like that, and I was exploding into shots, and I wasn't gonna get tired, and I was just gonna beat his ass. I don't know if I was gonna get a finish in that first round. He was tough
and patient. He was super patient.
He was patient, which was fine because it's easier for me. He wasn't doing anything. He was standing there.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking sucks.
That's the annoying thing. That's the thing I don't like about fighting that much. It's not like you can do everything right and not win. But
dude, I knock out Eddie Wineland. I peace. That was easy.
Mm-hmm.
He gets lucky and beats me and jumps up like he's fucking won the lottery. Yeah. That just showed me what kind of a bitch he was.
People think I hate him. So I definitely, six. You know, I got nothing against Tito. People think I hate him. I don't mind Tito.
Well, just people thought it was funny that you always said that wasn't a loss.
It's not. And then I'll die at that.
How is it not a loss?
I think Cheeto knows too. You go watch that fight. It's like he literally, it wasn't a calf kick. It wasn't a good leg kick. It was a kick he threw and I pulled out. With kicks, you either check them, step in, you eat it, or you pull out. I was pulling out and I've watched it. The slow-mo, his big toe literally like pushed a button. My peroneal nerve pushed a button and my foot just fell asleep. But before that, I was kicking him. I kicked him so hard he spun around. I was kicking his legs way harder than he was kicking mine. I was outstriking him. I don't think he punched me in the head once until the whole thing. And then I blitzed forward, and I went a step back. My foot just wasn't there. He got on top, elbowed me. It's a loss on the record, but I don't feel like it wasn't like I didn't go in there and lose because his skills were better than me. I do not believe that. If we have a rematch and he goes in there, beats me to decision, something beats me in any other way without some kind of – if he kicks me in the nerve again, I'll think he did it on purpose. I'll be like, okay, that's fair. That's two losses. But I just know it wasn't a skill set. It wasn't a lack of skills. It wasn't a – he didn't beat me because his skills were better than me that night. And it sucks. That camp was so fucking good. I had such a good training camp, and everything was so good for that. And just, it happened, and it was – I don't feel like I lost any stock or anything, and I feel like everything went as it needed to go, but – I'll never accept that as a loss. As far as mentally thinking, you know, I didn't get beat that night.
Hey, let's go, Tim.
Let's go.
You ready?
Yeah, I've never stopped training. It's been about 10 years of consistent training, so. It's just another fight.
Thanks, sir.
Balling.
This is a good party to us.
Jeez.
Hey, let me check out those three.
Yeah.
Last time.
Remember?
Yeah.
When you knocked out Eddie, he was over here, though.
That's true.
Sugar Sean O'Malley joins us here. Sugar Sean, how do you picture yourself taking on Thomas Almeida? How do you picture obliterating him?
In my head, I see a good, spectacular knockout. I want that knockout. I want that to go viral. I want a knockout that's going to drop people's jaws and just be like, what the just happened?
Oh.
The return of Sugar Sean O'Malley. I appreciate your time, and go get him on Saturday, all right?
Awesome. Thank you so much.
All right, bye-bye.
Thanks, sir. Sorry about that, Francis. We got the limo, bud.
That's scary to even think about. My heart rate just like... He scared me when we walked past him, but I think I scared him a little. I saw him like get a little intimidated.
What is that Nate guy's name that just yells shit?
Hey, baby, happy anniversary, 7 years. Here's to another 50.
Nate the Train?
I think Nate the Train. That just comes to mind. I remember him just yelling shit. Top five must watch UFC fighter. You gotta go with Connor.
Surprise, surprise, motherfucker. The king is back.
He's the most exciting. If Connor's fighting, I'm excited about fight week. I'm excited about Embedded. Like, I'm excited about everything. I think the fro, I miss the fro. My hair's too damaged now to do anything with the fro. I've colored it way too much. It's not super healthy right now. So the curl's gone, the fro's gone, but the fro, anything with the fro, shoes. You gotta have a good pair of shoes really can change an outfit.
Look at that. That's a walk off as clean as it get. Wanna play? Watch this. What the? That's my competition.
Oh!
I have as far as I see.
Oh well, yeah, thanks for that.
You can't feel more prepared than this. You saw me. I look, a million bucks, baby. I'm fast. I'm ready to go. Yeah, I think it's gonna be a kickboxing war. I haven't really watched a ton of his fights, but I don't think he really comes out and wrestles. You know, I think it's gonna be a kickboxing fight. I'm prepared for an MMA fight. I just think it's gonna be more of a kickboxing match.
You did mention though that you didn't really watch too many of his tapes. Why is that? Is that pretty typical for you not to focus too much on your opponent?
I watched just enough to know I'm gonna whoop his ass. You know, I'm prepared for his skill set. I'm gonna suck on one of those icy pops in the freezer.
You lost the last fight, so tell us what goes into that thought process. You know, I understand that it was a freak thing that happened, but ultimately, you know, you didn't win the fight. So, like, what goes into that thought process?
You watched that fight. I was piecing.
You were winning
up.
The fight.
I was piecing him up.
So, but Sean, did he got lucky?
I talked to the Sugar State Athletic Commission, and they took it away. It's not even...
Oh, okay. I like that. I like that.
£136, the official weight for Sean O'Malley.
£136.
The official weight, £136 for Thomas Almeida.
All right, moving on now to a featured bout in the UFC's bantamweight division. Sugar Sean O'Malley versus Thomas Almeida.
Thank you, gentlemen. Good luck tomorrow night.
Dateline, Las Vegas, Nevada. Sean O'Malley's in unfamiliar territory tonight. Having tasted defeat for the first time, his last time out against Sao Paulo's ball of power, Thomas Almeida. The Sugar Show is back in Las Vegas tonight as Sean O'Malley makes his seventh consecutive appearance here in this entertainment mecca. The breakout star from season one of Dana White's Contender Series, Sean O'Malley has made headlines from the moment he graced the Octagon.
Tonight, I have an extra ticket to the Sugar Show, and I'm giving Thomas Almeida first row seats, cage side, to watch it.
Thomas Domingo! Almeida! Sugar Sean O'Malley!
That perennial nerve,
yes.
Right? There you go.
And he just got kicked there right there.
Ooh.
And he returned fire. He's a hard guy to figure out. Like, look at that.
Oh, I think that kick might have hurt him a little bit.
Spinning back kick to the back body. Beautiful front kick.
Almeida needs to close the distance. Oh!
I cannot believe he's still standing.
Oh, and a follow-up left hand. Fight continues. Almeida back up.
Thomas Almeida is still there.
Oh, my goodness. But then he just took another left hand.
Oh another head kick. Almeida able to eat it somehow.
Oh, my
man. But Almeida, you know, hands up high, classic defense.
The movement. The traps that he sets and the ability to evade and avoid a lot of the strikes coming in his direction.
Now let's take a look at the high kick. Oh my goodness, that was shin to the chin. Amazing. I mean, of course he thought the fight was over. He knows what the feeling's like. You gotta take him out. He's not gonna quit. Beautiful low kick by O'Malley.
That was a beautiful low kick.
Oh my goodness, strong low kick by Almeida.
Yeah, that was nice.
Oh, Almeida landed a right hand there. There was another hard kick, too.
Oh, another
two
kick
hard
there.
Low
yep.
kicks.
That was
one on the outside
kick.
And one on the inside by Thomas Almeida.
Yes.
These are punishing strikes. They're really taking a lot out of the legs.
Oh, nice.
Sean O'Malley. Again, punishing that left leg.
Hey, this round, don't be afraid to dance on him a little bit more when you're backing up left and right, okay? He's gonna come a lot more urgent this round because he knows he's down by two, okay? Yep.
Ooh, strong low kick by O'Malley.
And it seems like that one has finally impacted the mobility of Almeida.
Ooh.
There it is again, right? He lands his, and then before Almeida can throw the return one, he's out of the way.
Good spin to the body there by Sean. Oh, and then he went high again.
I mean, the moment of just finishing Thomas Almeida would have been big enough for him, but now he seems to be on his way to a decision.
Yes. Nice knee to the body there by O'Malley. That front kick up the middle.
Oh, that left hand hurt him bad. He's doing it again.
And again, the hesitation.
Oh! Holy smoke.
Wow.
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 Joe, maybe he should have stopped it on the walk-off so that he didn't have to take that shot. High kick lands right on the chin of Almeida. Hurts him bad. That front kick was invaluable tonight. As he enters, watch this little short left hand. Boom! Drops Almeida. Ref's like, no, you gotta keep fighting. I mean, wow. Yeah. And it flattens him.
Declaring the winner by knockout, Sugar Sean O'Malley.
You know, I thought he was done. He's tough, dude. That dude's legit. You know, that dude's legit. You know,
so
he's not,
tough.
He's a tough dude. I only get 15 minutes to perform. You know, maybe a couple times a year. When I get in there, I gotta do something sweet.
Well, you certainly did at the end.
I gotta prove a lot of stupid people that they're stupid. It was nice.
You showed improvements and you got that knockout that you wanted.
Fucking love you, Joe Rogan.
I love you too, Sean O'Malley. Congratulations, sir.
Thank you.
Last thing I did want to ask you about was Sean O'Malley. Gets a performance of the night bonus. Could have had one in the first round. So I just want to hear what you thought about the whole performance, right? Like, thought he had a walk-off and then ended up getting a walk-off anyway. What did you think about him as a whole?
Stayed on the outside and basically did whatever he wanted to do. Hurt him, you know, thought he finished him, and then finished him again in the third round. So you really couldn't put on a better performance than he did tonight. That was fucking weird, huh? Holy shit. What the hell was that all about? He's ready to fight for me? He doesn't look like he's in fighting shape.
Congratulations on the win. Initial thoughts after a pretty insane fight like that?
My shins hurt really bad.
Those are my initial thoughts.
Well, I was going to ask, was that kind of shimmy walk you did out of the octagon kind of a nod to all the people saying just kick him in the legs?
That was a big fuck you to a lot of people. I've been getting mess for 8 months. I've been having to deal with weak ankles, so it felt good.
And then even watching it, Thomas has this very traditional Muay Thai stance, where he's kind of flat on his, heavy on his right foot. Obviously, you're confident in your skills, but is your style just tailor-made for someone like that, that is very linear and flat-footed while you dance around in front of him?
Yeah. This matchup excited me. Exactly. That shot, it was unnecessary. I looked in his eyes. He wasn't there. But, you know, in the first round, after the ref said, hey, if I don't stop it, you know, you gotta keep fighting. So I had to give him one more little juicer to the lips.
Joining us now is a man who has a 13-1 record fighting other humans. Woo. He's also the host of the Timbo Sugar Show, which is a podcast that you would enjoy the hell out of. And this past weekend, he knocked at another human. Ladies and gentlemen, Sugar Sean O'Malley. Yeah! How are you, man?
Dude, I'm doing good. You misspoke. It's 13-0.
No, okay, that's on me. 13-0, that one time didn't happen. How are you, brother? How are you feeling a couple days after the fight? What a performance by you.
Thank you. I feel good. My hands are a little sore and my shins are a little sore. But other than that, man, I can't complain.
Okay, I always wondered with you fighters, okay, because, you know, when I'm at a bar and they have that thing that comes down, tells me how strong my punch is, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, you know, a little intoxicated, and you hit that thing a little bit wrong, you feel like you break something in your hand. You know what I mean? You just feel like the next day you're an idiot. What happened? Oh, I was drunk fighting that thing. I always wondered, how do you make your hands tougher? Is this, you can just punch whatever? You got cinder blocks as hands? Or do you break your hand whenever you're, you know, breaking people's faces professionally?
It's nice when you get a good wrap, though, before the fight. You wrap your hands, and, you know, that saves it. If we didn't wrap our hands, you know, definitely we'd be, probably break them more. But no, honestly, my hands feel really good. But yeah, they feel good.
Hey, when are we going to get you a championship? You know, you're 13-0, undefeated. When are we going for it? Because your clip, your quote after the fight, I only get 15 minutes to perform. I got to do something sweet or something like that. I was like, this guy is maybe my favorite fighter I've ever seen in my entire life. You view it as like, hey, I got to do something sweet. You could have done it a couple times. You knock him out. I want you to be champion. Let's make you the face of UFC here.
That's the plan. The real reason what happened is before the fight, I had undefeated shirts made up that say another right hand from Sugar Land. So I dropped him in the first round, but I dropped him with a left hand. I wasn't walking away because I didn't, because I thought I'd walk off knocked out. I was walking away to let him back up so I could drop him out with the right hand so I could sell my shirts.
That front kick up the middle.
Oh, that left hand hurt him bad. He's doing it again.
And again, the hesitation.
I just captured the moment. That little jump shot.
Stop.
Yeah, that one was, that's perfect. That, it seems like this guy's got it figured out. No, it definitely feels like home. From Montana, haven't been back in a while. Arizona feels like home. Yeah, when I first moved, I was 19 years old. I was an amateur. None of this was guaranteed. Like, in my head, it was gonna happen. Like, I did see all this happen. I did see me getting in the UFC. I did see me becoming a star. But once I moved down here, it really was just train, and I enjoyed training. I didn't care. I wanted the money. I wanted the fame. I wanted all that. But it's the training I enjoy. I really do enjoy training. I enjoy getting my heart rate up, pushing the pace.
Front kick up the middle.
Oh, that left hand hurt him bad. He's doing it again.
And again, the hesitation.
Oh!
He gets another highlight for the real Sean O'Malley.
Yeah, I got to prove a lot of stupid people that they're stupid. It was nice.
But I think people are starting to see the more comedy side of me, the more entertainment side of me, but how people perceive me. It's just because everyone's so different. Some people think I'm cool. Some people think I'm a most people think I'm cute. I don't know. What do you think, Elena?
One, two, three.
Thank you so much. Yeah, appreciate it, man. Good luck. I'll be watching, man. Be watching. Good luck, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Schmo Zone. We are here in Las Vegas. We have Tim Welch, the head coach for Sugar Sean O'Malley. And we have Sugar Sean O'Malley right here in the flesh.
A lot of people are like, you're trying to copy Connor and stuff. It's just so stupid. But I remember I messaged him on Twitter that night. I'm like, dude, I learned that from you. I was like 21 years old.
I'm not used to this yet. I told you.
I know. I was in my mom's house chilling, getting a bunch of DMs from random people telling me I'm gonna get knocked out. And then that's when I found out.
What'd you get, like a week? A little over a week?
10 days, yeah.
Gentlemen are going to be with me. Let's get inside real quick.
The undefeated Sean O'Malley, of course. Another fight week for you. Will give us the feelings right now ahead of another big fight for you.
The crowds are back, and I clearly don't need them to go out there and perform. I've proved that. And but the fact that they're coming back, it ups everything.
But does it feel almost like a no-win situation? I mean, obviously this guy comes in and shocks you. He's shocking the world. You beat him. It's like, oh, O'Malley beat another can. You know, when are they ever going to test this guy?
You know, he might be thinking it's a win-win for him. He goes out there and loses. He's in the UFC. But I don't just knock people out. I change people's careers. I really, you know, mentally, the way I knock people out, they gotta, you know, they step into that cage, they're different the next fight out there. So this could be the beginning of his career, or this could be the end of his career. We'll see.
Coming into Las Vegas, the big fight card at T-Mobile sold out, kind of the first big event here in the fight capital of the world. Can you talk a little bit about being on this card, the importance of this, and kind of getting back to normal with everything?
This could be potentially the biggest card ever, or biggest pay-per-view ever. More eyeballs than ever. And though there's a ton of celebrities that are going to be out, a lot of people performing in Vegas that weekend. So all eyes are on the fight card Saturday night. I feel like my fan base is just as excited for my fight as they are the trilogy, Conor versus Dustin, which is insane. And I think the numbers will show that. I don't know if you can really prove that at all, but if you can, I think it would show that.
Conor McGregor has left a lasting legacy on the sport. How has he inspired you as a fighter? Because he's obviously changed the game in terms of not just being a fighter, but being a superstar.
The way he carries himself, the way he handles pressure, the way he goes into these big fights, I've learned a lot from him. I'm pumped to meet him. I've never met him, so it'll be cool. The idea is hurt him. I want to hurt him. I got to hurt him first. And then I get the spectacular knockout.
We're going to head upstairs and knock out a couple interviews.
Perfect.
After this is where I go to build my legacy and a guy that has so much hype behind him. And if I can get that done, I'm one step closer to that. I'm just ready to go out there and be hungry and show the world how I fight.
I still feel pretty good. I just know how good I'm going to feel.
You feel soft.
Once I carb up and get those calories in my body, I just look at it as another fight, just another name, just another face to add to my collection of highlight reel knockouts.
All right, next fighter to the scale, set to make his UFC debut live on pay-per-view tomorrow night in the UFC's bantamweight division, Chris Moutinho. 135, the official weight for Chris Moutinho. All right, next fighter to the scale, charged with opening the pay-per-view tomorrow night in the UFC's bantamweight division, Sugar Sean O'Malley. The official weight, 135.5 for Sugar Sean O'Malley.
And now for the ceremonial weigh-in for UFC 264. Here is Joe Rogan.
What's happening, my friends? Welcome to the weigh-ins. Live on pay-per-view, we kick things off in the bantamweight division. Sugar Sean O'Malley versus Chris Moutinho. Official weight, 135. 135. Sugar Sean O'Malley. Official weight 135.5 for the Sugar Show. Chris Moutinho and Sean O'Malley.
Man, is it great to be back on a bustling Vegas Strip and inside a banged out T-Mobile Arena. And there he is, the budding superstar and bantamweight hopeful Sugar Sean O'Malley, Chris Moutinho. He put on an offensive clinic in his last regional bout. He had been on the UFC's radar for a while.
From Always Sunny in Philadelphia getting a nice pop. Also in the building, the future Hall of Famer, Max Blessed Holloway.
Well, no fight fan will forget the night Sean O'Malley burst out of the world fight scene with a knockout on Dana White's Contender Series in 2017.
Tonight, it doesn't matter who's in the octagon with me. I'm going to knock him out.
Tonight, on a massive stage, O'Malley aims to repeat the result in his home away from home in Vegas. Doesn't get better, doesn't get bigger. Here is Chris Moutinho out of Milford, Massachusetts for the UFC debut.
Chris Moutinho is stepping into this octagon with an incredibly gifted, talented fighter that has a massive amount of momentum.
I tell a nigga, don't dick ride, don't blink ride, leave it to the double thick thighs, twin sisters. Drop it down and wobble, wobble up, mommy boot it up, shake it down and gobble, gobble up, cause my money up. Slide, slide in the belly trucker, the rave trucker, your bestie is a dick sucker, I big double. Catch him at the chicken spot, up a couple chops. Pop that nigga with 100 shots. Da, 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 da. They didn't make that nigga diddy bop. Cha 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 cha. Heat the windows going knuckle up. Bitch, I don't box. And these niggas always talking shit. Yaddy yaddy ya. When you see me, what you talking about? Fuck you talking about? Niggas always wanna chase clout. Bitch, I am clout. Tell him get up on my face now. Fuck. Are you dumb?
And grapes. Think you holding weight, then you haven't met the apes.
Stop, drop, shut them down, open up shop. Oh, no, that's how Rough Riders roll.
Declaring the winner by TKO Sugar Sean O'Malley.
Let's talk about when your opponent drops out, and that new guy comes in. Do you try to do research? What do you do? How does this, what was your plan going in? Does it matter who's there? Did Moutinho becoming your fighter, your opponent, change anything for you going into the night?
Yeah, well, there's the orthodox position and there's the southpaw stance. The kid I was originally going to fight, orthodox. Sparred orthodox guys for about 6 weeks. 11 days notice. They say, hey, you're fighting southpaw, which, you know, doesn't matter. When you're the best striker in the UFC, it doesn't matter. But I think maybe, you know, I spar a couple southpaws. I could put that kid's lights out. I still had 30 seconds to put his lights out. Herb Dean had seen enough. Not mad at the stoppage. Really wish I could have put his lights clean out. But all around,
overall performance, I'm happy with it.
Yeah, another TKO, by the way. I mean, technical, but and you're still undefeated, so you should be pumped about it. It was the best performance we've seen in some time. You were shit. Okay, you dedicated the game to the Phoenix Suns, okay? Hometown Phoenix Suns about to win the, or won the NBA champ, about to win the NBA championship. You're shaking him in the middle of the fight, and you just called yourself the best striker in the UFC or whatever. That has to be real. You were just, you know, me and that Oculus, it looked like you were just playing against a robot almost that was set on get back up and get in the face. Get back up and get in. Get back up. It was, and I think you did knock him out once early there, but what was your mindset? Like, dude, this guy won't go. Like, did you have that? Did you think, like, what do I have to do to this guy? Because he was literally like, I mean, there might have been a bag of peanuts up there. I don't know how your head takes that much trauma and doesn't go out. What were your thoughts while that was all going on?
2 days before the fight, I thought about that. I was like, God, it'd be sweet. I was like, the only way I could get front courtside tickets to the next game is if I call my shot, this game's for the Suns, and I go out there, dribble on him and knock him out. And I was that close, man. I was that close. Hit him with a nice couple dribbles. Made that up 2 days before the fight. But yeah, that dude was so tough. I couldn't put his lights out. I had 30 seconds left. We got 15 minutes. I had 30 seconds left. People said I was getting tired, but I'm pretty sure each round my punch count went up. Breaking records is exhausting.
Sean, the people that were saying you were tired, by the way, a couple of the commentators said it a couple of times. Mm-hmm. Like, they thought that Moutinho had kind of like, what's that, rope-a-dope, like kind of Homer Simpson or kind of took the beating, and there he was almost putting you. It felt like every round they wanted you to kind of get beat because of how bad you were just punching him in the face. You weren't tired at all, though, right? You said your punch count goes up. Were you exhausted? Was there any part of your body that was hurting? I mean, you played bongos with another human's face, skull, for 14 and a half minutes.
Dude, I was tired. He was tired. Anyone that fought in that cage that night was tired. And I kept looking at the clock, and people think if you look at the clock, that means you're gassed out. But I don't know. Have you, when you were in the NFL, you ever look at the clock before? Just, you know, you want to know how much time's left in a quarter? I think it's strategy. You look at the clock. It's like, okay, I need to know if I have 3 minutes left, if I have 2 minutes left, if I have a minute and a half left. So anyone that says that if you look at the clock, it means you're tired is stupid.
Sean, before we get to something fun, I had a question, right? This is from me to you. So when I'm calling your fights, I think that you are just phenomenal. Right. But then I've made some comments about looking up at the clock and everything, and you've gone about talking about it. So for me, my question is to ask you directly, Sean, what are you looking up there for? Tell me in that moment, because I don't know what I'm missing. Right. Now, you will say things like, hey, I think DC and Joe really like me, because we do. We think you're phenomenal. But then you also say, but then they'll say things like, he looks up at the clock. This guy's a world champion. I don't know why he doesn't understand that. But for the vast majority of the people that look up at that clock, they're a bit fatigued. So tell me what you're doing in there. You just, like you said something like, I want to know exactly where I am. So just tell me, I'm trying to understand, when you make that statement, tell me, Daniel Cormier, like what you're doing out there.
I'm Michael Jordan in the fourth, and there's 2 minutes left. I got to know how much time there is. I got to know how many points I got to score. I got to win the game. It's always fourth quarter in the fight. It doesn't matter if it's first round, second round, third round. I need to know how much time I have left. With the Holly and Piva fight, I hurt him with, I think, less than a minute left. You know, I had a good idea of how much time was left in that round. Do I expand? Do I put out this energy and try to put his lights out? Or do I save it because there's only 10 seconds left and I don't think I'm going to, and I don't want to empty my tank. I still have 10 minutes left. I think it's just, you know, like I said, I'm very experienced. I've had a lot of fights, and you know, it's 15 minutes is a long time to fight, and I want to make sure I have the energy to be able to last the entire 15 minutes. And it's just energy. I want to be energy sufficient in there.
YouTube fam, it's fight week. Is it Monday or Sunday the beginning of a week?
Ooh, Monday.
It's the end of, it's almost fight week, man. Start my water load today, 6.7 liters, which is like 1.7 gallons, which is like a lot of water, which means I'm like peeing like 30 times a day.
Oh.
today. We're going to bust out the podcast this afternoon.
Bye-bye. Love you.
Well, your glass, with your glasses on, you can't see your eyebrows. If you take them off, you'd be a fucking pedophile. You look like a pedophile. Speaking of, all going to be at the fight. It's going to be fucking legendary. Take some shots for the boys after. Some happy dads, maybe. I don't know. I'm not getting black, though, I decided, you know?
Episode 166, see you next weekend.
Hopefully I'm with the W.
I'm not dead.
Hopefully I'm not dead. Yeah, I took a picture. I took a picture.
So, yeah.
Is that Jay?
Yeah.
I don't remember. Peace.
What? I was trying to find a 60 and then I found a bottle, but she was so thirsty.
Oh, yeah, I forgot to give her water today. I just got done streaming, won the Redbox Regionals, go figure, making a little lunch. And tomorrow we're gonna do my hair, and tonight we're gonna pack. So come on over with me and hang out. We grab the groceries, okay. Eyes are so open because I'm sober.
What's first?
First comes first in the realest. I'm gonna grab some camp with the realest. We got some bucha. Some bucha. What up, big dog?
Maybe that's Jesus saying you can't have any avocados tonight.
Damn, I'm a go. Yep. Out here trying to play with me like I'm new to this. I'm a contender, you a pretender. Cut that foolishness. See my pedigree. If you ahead of me, you need to watch your six. Yo, ship sink you. I wouldn't
make in the cart. Sono, I found your girl. I found your girl, champ. I found your girl. Life's the place, say God, girl. I'm gonna get her for you, champ. I'm gonna lock her down for you, champ.
Dude, I thought I got the other day, Elena. Will you
gotta tell me how you
look? Elena, you like this one?
Elena, be honest.
Be honest now.
Don't lie.
Like that, Elena?
I don't know, man.
Oh my gosh, Elena.
What the heck are you freaking doing?
What's in your hand?
Are you ticklish?
That's so cute.
Are you ticklish?
Let's see your teeth.
Let's see your teeth.
What am I gonna wear, you say?
Ooh, classic.
Yeah, what is it?
Love that, yeah.
Oh, what is it? Is it Tuesday?
Oh, baby.
Ugh, I don't want to. I don't. I just don't. No, I don't even want to. Don't at me. That, right?
Yeah.
I should fit in this one now that I'm skinnier. Yeah. That one's pretty
small. Try it on one. I know. Four.
One of them. Well, I have three. I have the media day, press conference, post fight.
Oh, fuck. Some real ass spikes.
White Vans of the suit?
Yeah.
Another one, two?
Two. Mm-hmm.
Here! Look at her!
She smiles. I like this one, too. Elena, you like this? I actually don't like it. But yeah, I'm definitely bringing that. That's dope.
Elena, this way.
About 15, 20 minutes till Danny makes, till dinner's done. So I'm gonna go do my hot, cold. And after my cold plunge, I haven't been getting in the shower. because I've been letting my body warm up, warm my body up, warm itself up, rather than the shower warm me up. Something good for your metabolism or some shit. Science, I don't know. Elena, you got anything to say? It's hot, it's cold, ended on 3 minutes in the cold, and it's freezing. Danny's whipping me up a little din-din. Watch the Broncos Chiefs. Got a little $15 on the game. Got to finish packing tomorrow. Hair's going to look sweet. That's about it. Sunday morning, good morning. It's about 8 a.m. About to make some coffee. About to make some, little bit of breakfast. We're just big girls, aren't we? We big girls?
Hotel Indigo Atlanta
downtown.
Elena.
Located in Atlanta.
Steps from
America's.
Hola.
Oh, hello. Oh, you can't be.
Hi. Hello. Alright, YouTube fam, I'm about to do my hair.
So fun.
Pink sweep.
But he could, like, get this one. Okay, gotcha. So what do you
want to
do? You
want to
outline?
You ahead of me, you need to watch your six. Your ship sink you. I wouldn't blink, you know that. I think I could float. Y'all ain't know my level, it's a joke. I'ma buy my money, get the dough. Talking wild out here, get the smoke.
Can you do me a favor? Can you count to five? Just get an audio test on our end.
1, 2, 4, 3, 5.
Sounds great. Sounds great.
Have
a good interview. Yep. Yeah.
I'll try.
You'll choose one
normally.
Sean O'Malley.
What are you laughing at? Oh, I'd rather be playing Call of Duty, but whatever.
Can you give us some insight? Like, what are we doing here?
I can't give you any insight, because I'm not sure what the hell's going on. They're just painting, brushing my hair, and putting cotton balls in it. Well, YouTube fam, how the fuck does it look? I look like a fucking, a nerd's candy. It was 6 hours of me just sitting here, meditating, not complaining once. Right, Nolens?
Yeah, they didn't complain one time.
Nope. Tuesday morning, taking off with the boys. Headed to Vegas.
Gotta get a little workout in before we shower up. Gotta wash, shampoo, condition my hair per Danny. Just listen to her before she goes and does my hair, so.
Pedro's a great opponent. He's fought the top five guys and they couldn't put him away. He's never been finished. He's very durable. He trains at a really good gym. So we know their game plan is going to be good. He's going to come out ready to fight, but I just think Sean's on another level. I'm just excited to see the growth. You know, we're about to bust into the top 10 and start fighting the super elite guys, and I'm excited to show the world that he's ready for that.
I didn't really choose Pedro as an opponent. You know, I entered the top 15, I think I'm number 13, and UFC offered me Pedro Munhoz, and just, you know, that makes sense. Everyone wants to see me fight a top 10 guy. No one's put Pedro's lights out. His last four losses have all been the world champions. And I do believe that I'm Pedro's toughest fight, and that may sound silly now, but Sunday, you guys can rewatch this and be like, oh, shit, he wasn't lying.
We're gonna touch up his base first and then fix a few bands we had from last time. Like, you can spend a lot of money on the color, but the hair care after is the most important aspect of coloring your hair. So his hair routine is pretty high maintenance.
Yeah, the color of the hair, I mean, I guess you'll just have to wait, sit here with me for the next 3 hours and find out. I guess you'll find out what color it is. I've given a couple hints, maybe, on what the hair color will be like, so I guess you'll have to wait and find out for the next episode.
You got one beso? One beso. One beso.
Bye, love you.
Love you. My baby.
We'll see you in a couple days, okay, princess?
Love you too, thank you for everything. Okay.
We are ready, sir. Holy
I'm not even sure this thing flies.
There's enough alcohol in here probably to injure a small pony, so be careful with that. And let's get out of here.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So as soon as we get the engine started, we'll turn the air on and it'll be nice and cool for you.
Atlanta sucks just because Danny says, like, once I am gone, she like, where's dad? Like, she does notice I'm gone, so that kind of sucks. She didn't really realize I was leaving this morning, but it's only a couple days. It'll be good. She's with Danny, who's the best mom in the world, so like, I'm comfortable. It's nice knowing that. So
just riding. I ride every day, just a little something. Have all my weights down from the last 6 fights. It's a little journal. It's fun to read back.
Easy, buddy.
Yes, sir.
The Raiders had their own turbo over there.
Really?
Yeah.
Safe and sound, boys. Thank you, sir. Made it like that. Oh, look at it. Look at that roll.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've got a hell of a card for you. Live in the green team, we'll take advantage of the match of the weight division. Pedro Munhoz versus Sean O'Malley.
While UFC 276 was full of awesome moments, one moment stood out as an eyesore compared to the others. Pun intended. Sean O'Malley versus Pedro Munhoz ended in a no contest, and a lot of people weren't sure what to think about it. Let's check it out. Sean was hoping to be the first to knock out Pedro, but the fight ended with a no contest, thanks to an accidental eye poke. In the end, the entire crowd booed loudly at the result of the fight, but Sean walked around the cage as if he had been victorious. Some fighters came out on social media to support Pedro through the injury. Casey O'Neill tweeted, "I urge every fan who boos an eye poke to take an eye poke, then continue fighting another killer. SMA." While quite a few others came out to question Pedro's intentions with calling it quits, Bryce Mitchell tweeted, "Shit, at least take the full 5 effing minutes and try to recover. He's wanting a lucky decision, ain't he? He won round one, so he just wanted out real quick, I guess." Derek Brunson tweeted, "O'Malley showed great composure. Had Pedro fighting his fight, was winning 2-0 with little action, IMO." Vince Morales tweeted, "Give O'Malley the title shot, LOL." Of course, one of O'Malley's biggest supporters is O'Malley himself. While he obviously thinks that Pedro is looking for a way out, he also had some words to say about the glove design. Here's what Sean had to say.
Sean, obviously not the way you drew tonight up. So your initial thoughts on what happened up there, the way the fight ended, and everything going on in your mind right now?
Yeah, initially, like, when it happened, I'm like, okay, it didn't feel like it was bad. I thought we were going to be fighting in 20 seconds. Like, I didn't think the fight was going to be stopped. I was dominating that fight. I checked every one of his leg kicks. I could feel his shins cracking. Every time he would throw a kick, I would check it, and I could tell it would hurt him. I didn't get hit one time. I was dominating that fight. I was piecing him up. I was finding my range. It sucks.
A lot of people online, and I know a lot of fighters don't really pay attention to that, but a lot of people think that he was looking for a way out.
100%, that's what's going on in my mind. I'll have to rewatch it. I was piecing him up. I didn't get hit once. He came in there, he said, "I'm gonna kick his legs and try to take him down." He tried kicking my legs and it damaged him more. He couldn't get me up against the fence. He couldn't take me down. I was dominating that fight.
Do you want to just run it back with him, or do you feel like you've won the fight in some way and you're just ready to move on to the next thing?
It's a weird feeling because I do feel like I won the fight, but it's not like the emotions of winning a fight. I was winning the fight. I mean, I can't believe this judge's score. I literally didn't get hit. Were they watching? I didn't get hit. How could you score that? That makes zero sense.
And Peter Yan versus Sean O'Malley got booked. What was the thinking of that?
Yeah, so you know, we were in matchmaking, and Sean Shelby actually came up with that fight. Sean Shelby wanted that fight. I said, "Are you out of your mind? That we don't make that fight now. This and that." He told me why you make it, and O'Malley's ready. You know, O'Malley's about to be 28 years old in October, in his absolute prime right now. Hits like a truck, you know. He ended up selling me on it, and more importantly, both guys wanted it. And even more important than that, when we announced it, everybody went crazy and loves it.
All right, next up, you know who's coming out here is one of the brightest stars in the UFC today. Of course, it is the Sugar Show, Sean O'Malley. What's up, Sean? How you feeling, buddy? Big test coming up, Piotr Jan, former champion.
Yeah. Big test for Peter, October 22nd.
Sean, first of all, welcome to London. This fight, were you surprised when they brought Peter Jan to you after your last performance?
After getting a dominant win over a top 10 guy, there was no one else in the division Peter was the only one that didn't have a fight booked, and I was ready to, you know, book a fight. Peter said, "If I win, call him out." I didn't get the mic after the fight, but, you know, I think this fight makes sense. It's, you know, been a couple years coming.
Do you look at this fight as you testing yourself against the best, or you being able to prove that you're as good as you've been saying?
A little bit of both. Obviously, I haven't got to prove that Pedro fight didn't really end the way I wanted it to. You know, but I think I proved I can hang with the top 10 guys. You know, jumping up to the number one guy, this is a huge test, and I believe I will rise to the occasion.
Do you get a title shot if you win?
100%.
I brought Peter a present. Pink poodle, coming to kill the little Russian.
We're about 6 days out from the fight. So just running over the basics, running over a lot of his tricks, just keeping it fresh in his mind and just getting a good sweat, really. We're being a little bit more specific for Peter because, I mean, he's the number one guy in the world for a reason. He's got some of the best striking in the UFC, some of the best just top to bottom MMA in the UFC. We know what kind of tests we got ahead of us, but we're super confident in the preparation, so we're getting ready to go.
Camp was good. I worked hard, prepared, did everything what I did every fight, same as conditional work, striking work, wrestling work. I wanna win my next fight and I wanna fight for a title fight.
No doubt about it, Sean's a great fighter, smart fighter, good boxing. I just don't believe he's fought anybody like Peter Yan. No doubt about it. If Sean wants to box him, he'll soon find out who's the best boxer. If he wants to wrestle, he'll soon find out who's the best wrestler. Anything he tries to do, Peter's level with both.
For me, Abu Dhabi Emirates, it's best place. Yes, it's my history. Two times I won belts. First fight was with Jose Aldo. Second fight was with Corey Sandhagen. Now I want to smash my next opponent, yes. And Amali will talk before fight. I will talk my fist.
Well, we got here last Friday, so we've been here for about 9 days. I think my last 10 fights have been in Vegas, so it's definitely, you know, for me, I feel like I'm a high-level performer. I could perform anywhere. So it's not that big of a deal. Vegas was always just very convenient, 4 hours away from home. But now we're, you know, on the other side of the world. It almost makes it that much sweeter, though. I'm just very confident going into this matchup. I've been fighting 5'6" dudes my entire career. I'm 12 years into fighting, and this is just another guy. The best version of that style is Peter Yan. So I go out there and beat Peter Yan. I don't want people saying, oh, maybe Peter isn't as good as we thought. It's just I'm that good. I'm that good. I didn't think he was going to take the fight, to be honest. I'm ranked number 12, he's ranked number 1. I just didn't think he would take the fight. So I was messaging him on Instagram, talking a little trying to just kind of give him a little extra incentive to take the fight. He accepted the fight. I don't think he thought I would actually accept the fight. So, you know, here we are. I go out there and beat Peter Yan. I'm 100% fighting for a title. It's without saying. The fans want to see me be champ. They're missing that kind of like Conor feeling. He's not here. He's not been fighting. They need that guy, and I'm that guy. I go out there and beat Peter Yan. I go out there and beat TJ or Aljo, and then it's my era for the next 10 years. Thank you.
What I think really separates Sean from other MMA athletes is his mindset and how he's cultivated the ability to bring presence and intention into everything he does. I think what's really cool with the opportunity to work with Sean is just to see him continue to grow and to embrace not only his physical practice, but his mental practice. He continues to become a bigger star, and he's still very grounded as a solid human that works on himself. And that's a side that I think a lot of people don't see. It's a really cool piece of what makes Sean unique.
Welcome everyone to the open workouts ahead of the blockbuster event, UFC 280. First up in the bantamweight division, Sugar Sean O'Malley.
This is a massive fight. It's obviously not a main event, but this could be a main event. This is a massive fight. Because I have the skills, I have the abilities. Now I have the opportunity to go out there and show the world that I'm as good as I've been saying I am.
Give it up for Piotr No Mercy Young!
Безусловно, у него есть навыки в стойке. Он неординарный, нестандартный. Вот. Но если брать в целом его собранность, его ментальные составляющие, то я уверен, что я сильнее в этих аспектах.
If you are what you say you are, a superstar, then have no fear. The camera's here and the microphones, and they wanna know. Oh, oh, oh. If you are what you say you are, a superstar, then have
a fresh, cool young Lou, trying to cash his microphone, check 212. Wanna believe my own hype, but it's too untrue. The world brought me to my knees, what have you brung you? Did you improve on the design, did you do something new? Where you naming on the guest list, who brung you? You, the more famous person you come through, and the sexy lady next to you, you come too. And then the hitman, standing outside of heaven, waiting for God to come and get me. I'm too uncouth, unschooled to the rules, and too gumshoe. Too much of a newcomer, and too uncool, like Shadow and LaVille, I battle with it well. Though I need a holiday like Lady Who Sung Blue. Go back, whatever you did, you undo. Heavy as heaven, the devil on me, 2 tons too.
Fighting out of Phoenix, Arizona, USA, Sugar Sean O'Malley.
Wear your shades, the spotlights here can burn holes through the stage. Down through the basement, past the Indian graves where the dinosaurs laid, and out through China, nearly misses airliners, magnified times five. This is pointed at the rhyme, it ricochets off the moon and sets the forest ablaze. Now that's important to say, cause even with all that, most of us don't want it to fade. Duh. We want it to braid, meaning we want it to grow, meaning we want it to stay. Like the governor called, and he told him to wait. Unstrap him from the chair and put him back in his cage. The audience ain't fazed, and they ain't gon' clap, and they ain't gon' praise. They want everything back that they paid, cause they've been waiting since 10 to see the lights get dim.
If you are what you say you are, a superstar, then have no fear, the crowd. And the lights are on, and they wanna show. Oh, 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 yeah.
So chauffeur, chauffeur, come and take me away, cause I've been standing in this line for like 5 whole days. Me and security ain't getting along, and when I got to the front, they told me all of the tickets were gone. So just take me home where the mood is mellow, when the roses are thrown, M&Ms are yellow, and the light bulbs around my mirror don't flicker. Everybody gets a nice autographed picture, one for you and one for your sister, who had to work tonight but is an avid listener. Every song's a favorite song and mics don't feedback. All the reviewers say you need to go and see that, and everybody claps cause everybody is pleased. And then they all take the stage and start performing for me, like ha 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 ha, ha 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 ha.
If you are what you say you are, a superstar, then have no fear, the camera's here and the microphone.
Jugger! Oh,
woke up this morning ranked number one in the world.
Wow.
Shit ain't Photoshop.
I know you've been envisioning it for a long time, but what does it feel like now? Now that you, I mean, you knew you were going to get there sooner or later, but does it feel good?
It does feel good. It's crazy, like you said. It's like if I would have lost that fight, people would have been put a lot more respect on my name. They'd be like, damn, you lost, but the motherfucker's good.
Let's go to our next guest. I'm looking forward to talking to this man. He had, you know, honestly, like Islam won and it was a big deal. I felt like more people were talking about his performance, his fight, the result, the decision, and they're still talking about it. And he's even in the news today. I believe he is on the road. I believe he is not in his usual locale. I saw him on Saturday. He was in the front row at the Jake Paul fight. Very excited, as always, to talk to the one and only Sugar Sean O'Malley, who may just be the number one contender at 135 pounds. Let's say hello to the man. Hello, Sean. How are you?
Ariel, how's it going, brother? I'm doing good. You said may just be the number one contender. I am.
Okay.
Number one contender.
All right. I said that. And by the way, great to see you on Saturday. I want to ask you about that. But the reason I said may was, I don't know, you know, in the cage afterwards, you were sort of non-committal, kind of processing it all. I wasn't sure where you were at 10 or so days later.
Yeah, I mean, right after the fight, you get hit in the head a couple of times. You're exhausted. It's just like, I just wanted to sit down, watch the fight, you know, analyze my performance. And yeah, so I was able to do that.
Have you watched the fight?
Multiple times. Yeah, probably 5 times.
And you feel fair and square, there's no controversy, you won, right?
I mean, if you're judging that fight off of damage, I think 1 and 3 are clearly mine. Did you get a chance to rewatch it?
Yes.
What was your thought?
So, yeah, I mean, it's really one, right? One is the controversial one. It's so freaking close. I don't think it's a robbery. I just think it's like, I have no problem with it, honestly. Upon first viewing, I'll be 100% honest with you, I thought they were going to give it to him. I thought it was 29-28 for him. I thought first and second for him, third clearly for you. I don't know how the third can't be for you. That one blows my mind. It really comes down to the first, and I don't have a problem with it. I wish there were 2 more rounds.
Yeah. The thing is, that was the narrative too, kind of going into that fight. Was like, Sean's so lucky it's not 5 rounds. Like, well, I mean, didn't look like that. But yeah, I think 1 and 3 were clearly mine. I think a lot of the people initially that came out and were just so mad that I won were all the same exact people that were saying I was going to get absolutely smoked. So then I go in there and win. And now, you know, they're having a tough time. But I'd highly recommend everyone to go back and rewatch the fight before you make your solid opinion. But
yeah, I definitely think upon rewatching it, the viewpoint changes a little bit. I'm wondering, was he tougher than you thought he would be?
No, I went in there with, you know, expecting him to be as tough as he was, you know, the number one guy in the world. I do think if you ask him the same question, I think I surprised him a lot. I think, I don't think he was ready for me to be as skilled as I was or as tough. You know, I ate a couple left hands. He took me down. I was able to get back up. I was threatening off my back. So I think I was a lot better than he was expecting. He was as good as I was expecting. I was training and planning for the number one guy in the world, and that's what I got.
Fair to say that he took you to a place that you've never been before?
Absolutely. That's where that's what I train for, is to go to that place. You know, you can only train so hard in sparring and, you know, on the treadmill and stuff. So yeah, I was expecting that. And I even said going into that fight, I said, Peter's going to be the guy to take me to that next level. I don't think anyone's taking me there. Pedro, I thought, might be able to. Obviously, that wasn't a super tough fight or whatever. But I was planning on that. I was prepared for that. And I showed that I was prepared for that.
What about his power? Like feeling that type of power? What was that like? Because I feel like you've never been hit like that before, right?
Yeah, I've never been hit like that. He didn't feel like super, super strong on the ground. I never felt like I was going to get stuck in any positions or anything. As far as on the feet, yeah, he cracked me with a good left hand, hit me with a couple good shots. And yeah, I mean, I think that just goes to show how good a shape I was in.
Yeah, I think that what you did was, you know, hopefully, I don't know, maybe you're not getting, but like, hopefully the doubters are going away. Hopefully you proved your point. Am I wrong about that? Do you still feel like people are doubting you? Do you still feel like people don't believe?
Oh yeah, I mean, I go out there. I could go out there and just, you know, beat Aljamain, and they'd still say stuff. So I think it just comes with the territory.
All right, fair enough. By the way, how was the experience over there in Abu Dhabi? Did they treat you well? It felt like you were embracing it. The culture, the attire. How was it for you?
Yeah, I had a great time. Brought the team out. We were there for, I think, 17, 18 days total. Got adjusted. I'm glad we went out as early as we did. First time fighting out of the country. And, it felt like a second home as far as fighting. It felt like a second Vegas to me. So, you know, I really liked it. I wasn't surprised how many fans I had out there. Like, you know, walking around, it was, you know, the same as walking around LA, it felt like.
Wow. So are you fighting for the belt next?
Am I fighting for the belt next? I mean, if I have to go talk to UFC, I haven't talked to UFC yet. I'm going to go there maybe next week, I think, and sit down with Hunter and Sean and Dana. And so I don't know. If I had to guess, I would say yes. I would say my next fight, next time I step in the octagon, will be for the UFC title.
I just got to bring it to the attention, dude. That's all. You better watch who you're talking about. Running your mouth like you know me. You gon' fuck around and chill while the show me. Get caught and show me. Why one-on-one you can't hold me. If your last name was Hayne, only way you wore me out is stitch my name on your pants. No resident of France, but you swear I'm from Paris. 106 carats, total, no, that's Paris. Trying to confer this, my chain to your chain. I might sprint a Motorola, no service out of your range. You're out of your brain, thinking I'ma shout out your name. You gotta come up with better ways and actions to get your aim. All that pressure you applying, it's time to ease off. Before I